So yes, so we at the first ever Boiler Room Collections in South Africa, in Johannesburg. My second visit to Johannesburg, so it's yeah, it's pretty. I'm pretty honored to be here with DJ Okapi, which is the brains behind the Afrosynth pop blog, which is something I discovered back in 2012, I think, you know, through a friend's website, the Awesome Tapes from Africa website, and I came across all this amazing South African music that I grew up with, some of which I grew up with, and of course some that I've discovered and found out, or found some amazing records. So yeah, we're here with DJ Okapi. Tell us a little bit about this record playing here.
Well, first of all, thanks, and thanks for having me here, and welcome to Joburg, definitely.
Thank you.
Well, this is a record by Brenda Fassie. It's called Touch Somebody. It's one of the first vinyls I managed to pick up in Cape Town when I first started getting into South African music, on vinyl particularly. I can show you the cover here if you're interested.
And sorry to interrupt you there, but you're from Cape Town originally?
I'm from Cape Town originally.
Yeah.
I grew up there. I went to school there. Okay. I started DJing there as well, initially on radio, at UCT Radio.
Okay.
And then I got a gig in a club there called Marvel, which is in Long Street. This was
I know that, yeah. Seeing that I'm also a Cape Town born and bred.
And the place is still going. Yeah. It's still going strong. Yeah. So I got a gig there, I think, 2003, around there.
Okay.
A weekly residency for about 2 years, every Sunday night. And this started me really on the path to collecting vinyls. Initially, I was playing some vinyls, some CDs, things like that. Not playing only South African music. In fact, playing mainly funk and soul music. It was a hip-hop kind of bar and hip-hop kind of time and place in Cape Town. So I was kind of trying to tap into that, playing lots of funk and soul music, using the money I earned from DJing to buy records and try to grow my collection.
Okay.
And in the process of searching for records, I came across, I think, about 4 or 5 South African records from the 80s. And I bought them. I took them home. Obviously, I knew Brenda Fassie was. She's a household name in South Africa. But actually owning the stuff on wax is a different thing, you know.
Yeah.
And I wasn't around during the 1980s. I was born in 1983. So I didn't really grow up in the center of the kind of music scene, you know. Especially as a white guy in South Africa, maybe not necessarily exposed to kind of black pop music, you know, from the time. So I bought this rig, I started listening to it. I'm a journalist as well, so it became really interesting to me to see why there's no information out there on these kinds of albums, why you can't find this information online. so I started, basically did some small album reviews of these 5 or so albums that I picked up. The article was published in a newspaper, I think, called the Sunday Independent.
Yeah.
I balanced those album reviews with an interview with a guy here who's kind of been involved in the music industry for a long time, asking him about why the stuff's not there anymore, basically.
Yeah.
And just kind of putting it out there, and there was a decent response, and I thought, geez, this is a lot bigger than just one article or one interview. So I took that article that I wrote and I put those album reviews up online. I created a blog called Afrosynth.
Okay, so that's how it came about then.
Basically, and then I just
started
collecting
more. Sorry to interrupt you again there, but this record, so this is the first Afrosynth pop record you bought then?
You can say that.
And this is Brenda Fassie.
This is Brenda Fassie and the Big Dudes.
Yeah.
Before she went solo, and the album is called Touch Somebody. It's just a 4-track album. I've got a couple others by her since then. It's not her first album, but it was maybe one of her first big albums, we can say, you know.
And you mentioned there in Cape Town, of course, you were doing a lot of DJing at Marvel, playing hip-hop.
Yeah.
What were the record stores? Where did you actually go and buy the vinyl? I mean, I know from a few records growing up, a few record stores in Cape Town in the center. Rhythm Syndicate was one. And I think that was kind of one of the main importers of, from what I know back then, sort of more Chicago house music. But where, you know, I mean, probably then I wasn't exploring the record stores that much, but where would you go?
I think there's 2 different kinds of record stores, or more than 2 probably, but there's the guys who are selling secondhand, the old records, and there's guys who are importing the new stuff as well, you know. So where I got this from was a place called Revolution Vinyl in Observatory. It's still going there as well.
Okay.
They sell secondhand stuff, good deals, you know. So I'm not really buying new music, not buying new house music, imported stuff. I'm really just focusing on stuff I can find cheaper than CD, you know.
Yeah, of course.
Stuff that's affordable and stuff that's easy and interesting to listen to and to play as well, you know.
And then, of course, you were saying you discovered, of course, this Afro synth pop sound, and you know, you started having an interest in, oh, this is a South African sound. It was, you know, released round about the years or round about that you were born. I mean, I was born 1983 too, so I can it's kind of the similar time that I also probably discovered this sound, you know, growing up listening to Brenda Fassie, maybe a more later stuff, more to the 90s, but then discovering the music on your site, and I found out, wow, she did all these other things and all these other artists. So after this record, what would you say would be the records that then followed that were also around about the same time that are kind of special to you, that you thought, you know, is just some other records that you think would...
I'll show you a couple of others. But what I can maybe say first is that what I realized pretty quickly is that the music industry back then was a lot bigger than just the Brenda Fassie and stuff. And I realized that most of those dudes have just been... They've just disappeared, basically. You know, their music is gone. So I realized that for every Brenda Fassie, there's 100 or 1,000 artists who just put out one album, two albums. Great album, maybe still with a big label. But there's so much more music out there than just the big names.
Exactly.
You know? The big names are what you can still find on a CD compilation somewhere. That's the kind of stuff that does still survive, but it's everybody else. So the huge majority of those artists from the era that have no kind of longevity at all. Yeah. You know, their music is gone, their information is gone. A lot of them have passed away since then. So,
I mean, when this music, of course, was released, this music was the pop sound, you know, it was the popular sound around about that time, and so therefore there were so many other artists that was also doing around about the same sound or around about the same time, and it was kind of the Brenda Fassies and the Sipho Hotsticks. They were the popular, they were the more popular artists who got probably more record deals, who you know.
But they had a lot of imitators, and they had a lot of guys who probably innovated, you know, ahead of them, you know. They were probably copying other smaller dudes as well.
Yeah, exactly. So let's see, one of the tracks that plays whenever I talk about this, the track that just plays over and over in my head is a track by Hard, as well as I think Louis Vega, under his Hard Drive alias, Deep Inside. So deep down inside, that's all that plays in my head. So growing up then, and then of course listening to these records, and then moving away when I was 21 to the UK and been living there for the past 10 years, and you get to really, you get educated. I mean, I was lucky. I moved to Scotland, to Glasgow, where I had the opportunity to meet amazing DJs and for them to kind of educate me on all these records that I had, you know, because of course living in South Africa, you don't really have an idea of how old these records are, when they were released, blah, blah, blah. You just played them, my dad had them. And then also through that, doing a little bit of research, I found that house music was brought to South Africa around about the same time, you know. I would say between the late 70s, early 80s, they were imported here, you know. And it's funny because a lot of these house records also had certain messages, you know. Like one that stands out is a Frankie Knuckles record, Baby Wants to Ride. But in there, he says things like, South Africa set my people free, you know. So from the research I've done, I found out that actually in my community where I grew up, there was a guy that used to run this rent-a-disc. So it was a music library. You could go to him on the Friday, pick up your selection, your crate of records, go play your party, and then just return them the Sunday or the Monday, you know. And then also with my research, I found that the reason for this is that they were doing these illegal gatherings that were then sort of under pretense that it's a party, you know. So if the police came, whatever, in the apartheid times, the police would come and of course break up any gatherings. But if they saw, these people are just drinking and dancing and DJing, but they were actually conspiring or putting together plans, you know, to on perhaps marches or protests. But this was a way that they could do that, and this started the whole this is how, from my knowledge, this is how house music actually came into South Africa, and this is also why house music is so popular and important to South Africa. And then also again through all the records that were brought from, where the Chicago house records, Detroit, you know, the early synth pop records, you know, that had the disco records, how the South African DJs and, you know, artists, and how they interpreted that in their own way and then created what we know today as Kwaito, or, you know, the Kwaito sound, which is a very South African sound. And also from my memories from when I lived in South Africa 15 years ago, listening to YFM, listening to Glenn Lewis in particular, playing all these records, house records, at 33 instead of 45. So they were all slow and what they would say now these days, chuggy. And yeah, this is just for me, you know, discovering this and, you know, coming here and finding out that you actually have a record collection of Kwaito. Yep. Which is probably the, it's very rare that anyone has records. So,
I can show you a few.
Earlier I saw a very special record, which was Sharon?
Sharon D.
Yeah.
Let's whip it out, I guess.
Sharon D, which is again another massive classic.
I mean, maybe for viewers, it might be worth explaining. You know that. South African music industry stopped printing vinyls in the early 90s.
Yeah.
You know, there was a long time until quite recently that basically there were no vinyls printed at all. So the kind of the end of the vinyl era was this kind of early 90s Kwaito stuff you can find. And I think the influence from the DJs is quite obvious, because these guys were interested, always listening to overseas. You know, when they got tired of the funk and the soul, they moved on to the house stuff, I guess.
Exactly.
You can even find a lot of the, what do you call it, like Eurobeat, high energy stuff, European house stuff, you know, electronic stuff that was also popular and also kind of fed into Kwaito, I suppose you might say, as well. And it's all through the DJs experimenting, taking influence from overseas and the States in particular, but striving to really put their own stamp on it, you know, to make it a South African thing. So,
and then also the compilation CDs, you know, that's kind of, that got South Africa really locked, because the compilation CDs of all these records that were imported, the sound, you know, these select DJs, they were also buying records from abroad and putting them on compilation CDs, which also played a big role in people's knowledge on house music. You know, that's why, again, that's part, I would say, contributes to the popularity of house music in South Africa. That's why South Africa is such a successful electronic music, well, house music, you know, if you class it as that. I mean, South Africa, you know, everybody knows house music. It's not like it's house, it's just music. It's your pop music that gets played on the radio. Yeah. So it's interesting, you know, especially
exactly
living away from home, living away from South Africa for so long. And then, you know, you kind of discover things that you would never have discovered if you lived in South Africa. For me, it's been a crazy journey.
Yeah, it gives you perspective,
yeah,
I suppose.
Exactly. So this one is
Sharon D. This is from, so we can't really say this is the first Kwaito tune or something.
Yeah.
This is from mid-90s. I think Sharon D, maybe we can say she's one of the first big female Kwaito stars from back in the day. This track is actually called Local is Lekker, which just means local is cool.
Yeah.
Produced by Mduma Silela, who's became a big Kwaito solo dude in his own right, and also a producer still going strong these days, you know.
Yeah, we can always step into the other little gems that you have there. But referencing those organs, which a lot of those US producers were doing in the 80s and 90s, you know.
also heavily influenced by that sort of Robin S, you know, Show Me Love type.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, that's a good example, but there are better examples as well. You can really just hear that they're lifting it, and maybe they're just putting Zulu lyrics on a overseas track.
Exactly. Slowing it down a bit, you know. Yeah.
So the influence is there.
Yeah. Great. Listen to this song all day. Things very memories. So, moving on this Kwaito tip. I mean, for me, going out listening to it, I mean, then for me, I didn't pay much attention, you know. For me, it was just, I'm listening to these R30 records, Mendoza, PKZ, whatever. And then again, living away from home, you just listen back and go, they were actually doing some really cool stuff, you know, and there's probably so many records they done that I've not even heard before. And I know you've got a little bit of the earlier stuff, you know, the proper Kwaito vibes, you know. Let's listen to another, I think.
I can show you that Arthur.
The author.
So
I mean, Arthur was one of the biggest Kwaito artists of South Africa.
Yeah, he still is, you know. He headed a label back in the day called 999 Records, and he's produced a lot of the big acts. He's still going strong. A lot of these guys are kind of approaching middle age now, so they're not really like the biggest pop names, but Arthur's a household name in South Africa, definitely. This is a track I found that he produced. It's quite tricky, actually, because a lot of the Kwaito albums, they just have these plain white covers, you don't get too many details. You have to try and just do some detective
work. Look at the small print,
this is an album called Scotch.
Okay.
Buccaneer, yeah.
So Scotch, was that an alias he was using, or...?
There's a track here called Scotch. So I think Scotch is the title track. Buccaneer, is maybe the name of the act.
Okay.
The names on here are Gabby LaRue, this guy produced Mendoza's big hit, Oscar, who's still going strong, you know, and...
I was speaking to someone recently, actually, maybe a few days ago, about Gabby LaRue, that he was the instrumental producer behind all the big South African, like Mendoza and all these big Kwaito artists, you know. He was kind of the main producer.
Not the main one, but I think he did
he was one of the big hits.
He was involved with Trompies maybe before Mendoza or something like that. What I can say, we got a correction, is maybe it's Arthur's not involved in the Scotch album.
Okay.
It's this guy Oscar and Gabriel Russo.
Okay. let's have a listen to that anyway, seeing that we have it up.
So this is the title track, Scotch.
Okay. This is a typical Kwaito
intro, at least.
Yeah.
Abandona bala shi with you.
And in terms of going out in Johannesburg, I mean, I've not really explored the club scene that much. I mean, you play a few gigs a month,
sure,
you'd say?
Yeah, a couple of months.
And these records, I mean, you try and play as much Kwaito or Afrosynth records, you'd say? Or is it, I mean, I know you were mentioning earlier, you try and, you know, have a bit of a mix. Because, of course, depending on how receptive the people are to the sound, you know, everybody wants, of course, at the moment, the Afro house sound is very popular.
Yeah.
What percentage of Kwaito you'd say you'd play in a set?
It really depends on the venue, I would say, and the crowd at the venue as well, you know. I'm not I play the dance floors and stuff a lot, but I'm not a typical kind of DJ where it's just about getting guys moving and stuff. Often I just open up for other guys or close. So it's also just for guys to listen to, you know.
Yeah.
But I can say, ideally on a good day, I'll play maybe 50% local, 50% overseas. Okay, and a lot of that overseas stuff is American, but also throwing a lot of reggae music and stuff as well, depending on the setting, obviously, as well. This Kwaito stuff, I can't say that I'm an expert or that I have a massive collection. The majority of the stuff I have here is really 80s kind of Afrosynth stuff. Kwaito stuff is hard to come by. So the stuff I have, I've been playing a lot lately. Because it's more upbeat, it's still fresh, people enjoy it, a lot of people recognize the songs as well. But unfortunately, I can't play more than what I have, you know, which is only...
But what you have is probably more than I've ever seen before, you know. This is the thing, with the record stores that I've, especially in Cape Town, kind of just going into a few, there's Mabu Vinyl, of course. Even overseas, you know, because I would have... suspected that these records would have been imported or exported, to other stores, international distributors. But even going and searching for records wherever, I've never ever come across a Kwaito record, you know, or anything that sounds particularly Kwaito.
Yeah.
So I think what you have is probably more than I've ever anticipated you to have. So no, it's great. I mean, of course, it's easily accessible on CD these days.
Well, the big names are from the era. But I think, you know, like I was saying earlier, they stopped producing a lot of vinyls in the early 90s.
Yeah,
so I think the quantity of records they were producing was a lot less than
Rendezvous
and those guys.
Yeah.
The other explanation might be that the guys who did buy it, they hung on to it, you know, they're not parting with it. But Kwaito is definitely the tail end of the kind of vinyl scene, and it kind of... You can see the link with Afrosynth stuff before it, and the stuff that we still hear today. You know, it's kind of the missing link between today's music and the music of the 80s, I think.
Of course, and I think also with the sound, the popularity of the sound. You know, how the quieter sound maybe fades out a little bit in the house. Afro house scene is now very popular. You know, so people don't really pay too much attention.
That's
to that.
Exactly it. Is that quieter scene? I think by a lot of people as something that's now past its kind of sell by date, you know, it's from the 90s, and at the time it was a lot more, I think, vital, you know. Now guys tend to focus on house music. There's still Kwaito acts out there. Often they're guys who, Kwaito guys making house records or house guys claiming to make Kwaito records, so the kind of boundary is blurred a little bit, but definitely the music they're making now is not exactly the same as what they're doing back then.
Of course.
I think it's a lot more maybe international orientated or dance floor orientated, and back then it was still finding their feet a little bit, you know?
Yeah, trying to create something
new,
exactly. Yeah, so I think you said you've got another one or two for us there on the Kwaito.
I've got a couple cool ones, you know. Unfortunately, unlike other records I've got, I don't have the big hits in Kwaito. I've just got what I could find, and a lot of it is quite obscure stuff.
The people out there, now that we're giving them an insight onto the Kwaito sound, I think, I mean, for me, even becoming sort of heavily interested in the sound over the recent years allowed me to then explore and discover new artists and find out a little bit more about the sound, because of course moving away from South Africa, I was very interested in the electronic music and house and techno, and I wouldn't say I've got all the knowledge on that, but I've got enough for me to be able to now move on and find, so there was this music in my homeland, you know. So it's nice to be able to go on a little bit of a journey and discover this. And so what is this one then?
This is a guy called Sandy B.
Okay.
They couldn't even bother to print a nice label there, so it's just his name written on the thing. I did a little bit of research and actually find the song on YouTube. Sandy B is still going. I think he's a artist basically in KwaZulu-Natal.
Okay.
Still making music. let's listen to his track.
Was there also a Sandy? What was that? You Make My World Go Round. That was also a Sandy B, wasn't it? Was
possibly. I yeah. Don't know. Yeah. Like I say, you know, I'm just learning as I go. This is the track. I'm a jovi.
Okay, nice.
Quite a long intro.
Yeah. Which a lot of these records have, you know, nice little dramatic intros. Yeah, I was gonna say it sounds like this record's a little bit too slow. Maybe it's on the wrong speed.
That's exactly it. So they were just experimenting, and I think still finding the kind of optimum tempo for quite some music. Yeah. And also, a lot of the stuff does sound like it's slowed down. Some of it even sounds like it's too fast, faster than it should be.
Yeah.
I mean, I can flip it up if you want.
Let's hear what it sounds like at 40. At 40 or at
She's a rogue boy. I'm a jovi man. I'm a jovi man. I'm a jovi man.
I think it's the way the vocal sits, you know. The vocal sits just perfect for that kind of tempo. So listening to the track without that, I'm also curious to know, you know, did they know it should have been at 45 when they were creating it? Was it an accident where the guy was just like playing at 33 going, this is interesting, and then just kind of replicating that, or did they?
No, I wouldn't be surprised if the very first time it was by mistake.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a pretty easy mistake to make, I suppose, and they just thought, this is cool, you know, let's take it for it and see what happens.
Jovi.
I guess this is how he intended the song to be.
Jovi. Jovi. Yep. Yep. Yep.
So you say he's still around then?
You know, I've been in touch, I think he posted the video on YouTube himself, so he's still making music. This is a slightly older or younger generation, I suppose, because they came around the 90s, you know?
Of course.
These guys are still active,
I'm curious to know what they're making now, you know? And did you say he was from...
I think he's from KZN. I haven't done a huge amount of research, but he's out there, and guys can find him if they want to.
Because there's some interesting music also coming out of Durban that I've also discovered recently, this goom sound.
Just house music in general.
House music,
Durban
exactly.
Is like
the center of Victoria's world. Sandy B, I'm a jovi job. Sweet B, I'm a jovi job. I'm a jovi job, dance. I'm a jovi job, Sandy B. I'm a jovi job, dance. I'm a jovi job.
Nice. Let's play one more sort of on the quieter tip, and then we can go on. Because I really want to talk about this whole the popularity of this music also abroad now, you know, because I know a lot of people who are on this quieto Afrosynth, you know, discovering, you know, a lot of friends asking me, you know, to check records out for them, and I've recently picked up a record that we can chat about later. That's on Discogs for pretty a large sum of money, and it's going to be repressed soon. So yeah, we'll come to that. So we'll just listen. So what is this one?
This is another kind of studio effort, you know, with some recognizable names in there. But the title of the album is called Ghetto Thing. So the title track is called Ghetto Thing. The act of the band is called Out of Tune.
Okay.
And this song is called I'm a Cellular. So it's like listen to the lyrics, you'll see it's like it's a sign of the times. Definitely cell phones were just coming out. It was a new thing.
Of course.
So they're referring to pages and all this kind of thing. So it's interesting, yeah.
And they love their organs. So we just give it a clean. It's funny, I mean, I'm just, you know, just listening to this track, thinking of how this will go down in a club in London, or, you know, in Glasgow, where I play regularly, the reaction of the crowd, you know, and then versus playing that record here, you know, in South Africa. I mean, there probably will be a reaction in whatever circumstance, but...
it's a reaction for a different reason, probably.
Exactly.
That's what I always find really interesting as a DJ, that not just about the way you're playing a song, but it's people of different ages really respond differently and for different reasons as well, you know? Especially the Afrosynth stuff.
Yeah.
Like really, it's an eye-opening thing for me, definitely.
Yeah. No, because I... in Glasgow, again, a gig I did for Nelson Mandela, sort of the memorable day of Nelson Mandela gig we done for him. And it was done through the British Council, and there was loads of South Africans that came down, and I thought, now this is a perfect opportunity to play a lot of Afrosynth stuff. So dropping the Brendas, it's absolutely one of the recent tracks, the Vulindela. And the crowd and everybody breaks down into a dance, and also Mafiki Zolo, you know, some of Mafiki Zolo's first records, you know, and just seeing how, but it was an older generation, you know. I think if I came to Joburg or Cape Town and played it to a more younger crowd, they probably wouldn't have that same reaction, you know, breakdown.
Because it brings up different memories and different images in their head. You know? There's definitely a generation gap in South Africa.
Yeah.
People who grew up under apartheid and people who've grown up since then.
Yeah.
So for example, the Afrosynth stuff, if I'm playing it, often it's young black South Africans maybe who like it the least sometimes, because this is what my uncle listens to, or what my dad listens to.
My granddad is
too old school, and they don't relate to it. Whereas if it's someone from another country who doesn't even know the music, they listen to it with fresher ears. Yeah. There's less like baggage attached to that
exactly.
music. Versus the slightly older generation of South Africans who remember, you know, like enjoying it 20 years ago, and those are the guys that it speaks to deepest, because it takes them back to a place.
Part of their childhood, or their part of their upbringing, or certainly their first experience of going clubbing.
Yeah, all that stuff. So you can appreciate music, or you can enjoy music for different reasons. I mean, that's obvious, but like, it is just a good example of it.
Exactly, and if I look at it, my situation, being from South Africa, again, lived away, being subjected or being surrounded by electronic music and music from, you know, from America, from Europe. And then getting to a stage now where I'm thinking, I'm a bit bored of this, man, you know. Maybe I want to go back to the music where my friends in South Africa, people that I know, of course, everybody's more now focused on the music that I've probably listened to three, 4 years ago, you know, the electronic music, and they go, wow, what is this?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, okay, yeah, there is that difference. You know, I have been exposed to that music for a long time, you know, and therefore this journey of discovering music from where I'm from, you know, or from even from Africa, it's a little bit more exciting for me now, because then I find out that there was guys making electronic music back in the early 70s on synthesizers, you know, people like the very popular William Onyebo, of course, and a few others, and you just listen to their music and you go, wow, you know, this was so ahead of its time when it was released, and this is why it makes sense. Perhaps they weren't intentionally making that music for the future, but their music, of course, now speaks volumes, you know, in terms of the technology that the guy was using then. I mean, there are synthesizers, and everybody's of course going crazy for synthesizers in their music. They want to make their music analog sounding, where he was probably just going, yeah, this sounds cool, I'm gonna make whatever I feel.
He wasn't thinking about 30 years of the future.
He wasn't really thinking about it. So it's interesting also to see how music from Africa, how popular it's become, you know, with Europe and the States, you know, people like Nozinja does the Shangaan Electro. Speaking about him earlier, where nobody in South Africa knows him really, you know. They know Shangaan, they know the Shangaan traditional music. But then here's this guy doing something completely unique, Shangaan Electro, and then he blows up and he tours all over Europe and all over America. So this is kind of my thing. And then in saying that, you know, the popularity of these, the music coming out of Africa, also the records, you know, like for example, this Afrosynth pop records and the Kwaito records, you know, they go online on Discogs, on this vinyl market, Discogs, online market. And people then just start, you know, the value just goes out of this.
Yeah, putting a value on the music is very tricky, you know, I think. And it's definitely interesting. I mean, what I can say to add to that, you know, is that I think a lot of South Africans, myself included, we grow up being fed American music, you know, and it's sad, but it's a fact for a lot of people that you almost have to discover African music almost as a foreigner in a way, because growing up, at least in the 90s, you know, I was kind of just fed American music, and I had to. And it sounds similar for you. For it took you having to leave Africa to really appreciate African music.
Yeah,
and it's sad, but it's how it goes. I guess it's better than nothing at all. And I think here, for example, it might be the case where a lot of South Africans are looking overseas so hard that it takes an American label to release an African album for them to really appreciate African music in itself, you know.
Exactly.
Just the same kind of thing maybe with Paul Simon's Graceland as well. A lot of white South Africans really didn't know anything about black South African music. Here comes Paul Simon, makes Graceland, wins a Grammy.
Yeah.
And now suddenly they turned on to the stuff, you know.
Exactly.
So it's sad, but it's unfortunately, you know, South Africa has always been like almost a colony of America in terms of its culture, and like a lot of the world is, you know. We have a lot of local music that we can be proud of, but I think a lot of sections of South African society, particularly maybe I can say like white South Africans, they're not they don't know this stuff, and it takes sometimes like an overseas company to really give it legitimacy in their eyes for them to want to pursue it.
Yeah, or credible. Okay, now it's credible because those it's cool people are, it's cool now. And yeah, know, exactly.
So it's and a bit funny, you know. Yeah.
And it's the same thing. I've also, I wouldn't say fallen into that trap, but for me also being surrounded by people that are into the music from my homeland, it also makes me also go, oh, hang on, this is... You know, and then on a recent trip to Tanzania, I mean, I've been traveling East Africa over the past 9 months, and it's been exciting in terms of music, and then also seeing if I can get the opportunity to go into record stores, if there's any record stores, you know, because of course there is this popularity of being able to get records that are perhaps a bit rare, and I've had the luck to find one, which is later I'll actually take it out here. Which is, I think you have.
I got the same
one. Yeah, yeah, we can play that. And I mean, I don't know how much you know on of this record, and maybe you can shed some light for me too. Because yes, I know Ava as a South African artist. I know she featured in one of Michael Jackson's music videos. And but yeah, this record. Why this record is so.
It's just a great record.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But no, I think of course, musically it's a great record, but...
But I mean, these guys basically, South African musicians, you know, had a large, not a large, but I could say a group of South African musicians have been living overseas since the 1960s in exile. So they basically left South Africa due to political reasons. They weren't allowed back.
Yeah.
And Maria Makeba is the most famous example, Huma Sekela.
Yeah.
But also along with them, a lot of other guys like Kaifa Semenya and Leto Mbulu.
Yeah.
Settled down in the States eventually, these guys, and made a lot of good music, you know. Like Kaifa Semenya was involved quite closely with Quincy Jones, worked on the Roots soundtrack, Color Purple soundtrack as well, later featured in Michael Jackson's thing, probably through Quincy as well. And these guys, they really bring a new kind of perspective, I think, to South African music, because they were living in LA and living in New York and living in the UK and stuff, so they were engaging with international music community a lot more closely. So they're making South African music, but in a different context. You know, they weren't in South Africa under apartheid in that sense, you know, during the 80s at least. They had more freedom maybe to make the music they wanted to. Perhaps being outside the country, the same thing you say, they were more inspired to make South African music.
Yeah.
Whereas the guys locally maybe sometimes weren't thinking like that, and they were just trying to make American music sometimes, you know.
Yeah, which was a perfect example of the Afrosynth sound, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So these guys, it almost like flips it around. They're coming from the other area, but their roots are the same, you know. They come from Africa, they come from South Africa, so you can hear the same connection, but with the American kind of production quality and stuff as well.
Exactly. And one that stands out, of course, I'm sure you'd probably choose would agree with me.
That's the one I like, you know?
And which one is that? The set?
It's Normalizo. Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so this is a track I play often. Take a listen. I mean, it's slow, it's deep, and it's funky. You know, I like it.
Yeah. Yeah, just while the record's playing there, just to let the people know that this record is being repressed and it's coming out in May. At the moment, I think the highest price was sold for was about £215, averaging at the moment for about £100
for the original.
For this original version. Yeah, this is music. Music is. music, The Village Never Ends. Yeah. And yeah, this album, I think the lowest we sold for is about £50. Yeah, so I wonder how. It up for I think probably 20 pence, if that, you know. For those who want to get a copy of it, I'm not sure the label. I didn't take note of the label. I did see it because I was a little bit gutted, because I was maybe thinking of selling this copy. I'm not kidding. But yeah, it's, I think, yeah, it's about £22, which is great. I mean, it's amazing music. So.
But I think if you dig hard enough, you can probably find it for more acceptable,
yeah,
price.
For 20p.
Yeah. if you go
to Dar es Salaam, to the music and sports store, I'm sure there's more copies.
So a lot of these guys are still going strong. You know, I had the chance to see Letambulo and Kaifa Semenya live in concert at Moratella Park in Pretoria. Every year, basically, in Pretoria, they do a concert for the legends, you know, where they get them out and perform a lot of the stuff. So she's still going strong.
Amazing.
She did the song as well. It was great to see it. Man, it's always a trip, you know, like seeing, listen to something on vinyl and then actually seeing it in the flesh. It's something else. So it is great.
I can imagine. But this is, I suppose, for me, I'm also on a little journey to visit South Africa and explore South Africa a little bit more. I've been in Tanzania and Uganda and Kenya, but not really explored South Africa. Man, you know, I haven't really been anywhere apart from Cape Town, to be honest. So this hopefully is going to be the opportunity for me to go and discover.
Yeah, man, it's a never-ending thing, you know. And like I say, you know, I'm on the same journey, and I think everybody else is. Everybody who comes and says, "Hey, I know everything about any music," is lying, man. They're fooling themselves.
Yeah, exactly.
There's so much music out there, especially in a place like South Africa, where we have a huge amount of variety.
Yeah.
There's something for everybody here, definitely. You know?
And great music come out of South Africa. All these artists, you know, Spook Matambo. And the future sounds of Mzanzi. I know you've got the original Spook Matambo.
In a way, I guess you could say that. This is a guy, his nickname was Matambo. He's a quite a famous keyboard player from the 1980s. He played with a band called Hotline. His name is Ron Brittell.
So Spook, this is your...
I'm sure he won't mind if he doesn't know already, you know. But
and then also, I mean, South Africa, I mean, the music scene, of course, we've got our Black Coffees and all our Sulu songs. Mm. I know they our superstars. And then I think, our biggest export musically now, I could arguably say it's the Antwoord, you know. They are our... South Africa's, I mean, everywhere I go and I tell people, yeah, I'm from South Africa, you know, I've oh, so you know the antwoord? And I'm just like, yeah, you know. So they are, in some ways, I mean, of course, a lot of their music videos are incredible, the way it's shot. But if you look at the content there, you know, it's very explicit, you know, it's very in your face, which is an amazing thing to see how their sound has just taken over the world, to be honest with you. I mean, I had the opportunity to support them in Glasgow, and I come out and, you know, and I do the support act, and then 10 minutes later I look out and it's 4,000 people just all staring at me, and I'm just like, what do I do here, you know? And I mean, there was a little bit of reaction when I played whatever records I played, but then just to see the reaction when the antwoord actually came out on stage, you know, and just for that 45 minutes to see how the crowd reacted, it was just crazy. I mean, they've just got a crazy energy. I mean, it's like everybody on 10 cans of Red Bull, you know what I mean, at once. It's going absolutely mental. So yeah, so but I know again, you've got some inspiration, maybe Ninja got some inspiration from some of our.
I doubt it. I don't know if Ninja's been digging around in the record vault, but we'll see. Because here's something I found. It's like the original Ninja, we can say.
Yeah.
And I mean, that pose even looks familiar, doesn't it? But I doubt it was deliberate. But it just goes to show, you know, in music in general, I think the guys, you struggle to find stuff really original. You can just choose your influences. You know, I showed you that Mandre album as well. It's Daft Punk with Daft the masks Punk, and stuff.
I mean, that record, you had that record. Maybe there's an opportunity for us to play that record. Because it was somewhere in here. There we go.
Yeah, so this is Mandre as well. This is on Motown, so it's not local. It's an American dude from the mid-70s. Yeah, but basically, I think in general, I'm sure musicians would agree that most people aren't born in a bubble and just making stuff that's not influenced from somewhere else, whether deliberately or not. You know, some guys choose their influences quite wisely and choose to kind of choose obscure influences. Other guys will choose the mainstream guys. You know, so it just goes to show, you know, music. What goes around comes around, I guess.
Exactly. I mean, you'll never be able to be original, you know, but you can bring your original flavor, your personality.
You can find an original mix of influences. I suppose the best you can do. That's it. Do you want to
listen? Let's have a listen to that. And then, before we, I suppose we could sit here all day.
Come in.
It's not Motown's pop stuff, it's Motown's slightly more obscure stuff. This was 77. Musicians are like always just drawing influences from each other, and the same goes from Africa to the States, to Europe and back again, you know. And now I'm just relieved and glad that people overseas are taking interest in African music. I think it's a great thing, you know. I think too long artists here have kind of just been within Africa only, you know, within their country only, even in South Africa, just within a certain region, you know, based on the language they speak or what their background is. So more people take an interest in this music, I think the better, you know, obviously.
And people like yourself, you know, you involved your your Afrosynth Pop blog, you know, gives people an opportunity to listen. I mean, of course, you were saying to me earlier, you don't have enough time and, you know, to categorize and upload all these records. But I mean, even the little bit that you are uploading, you know, does change. I mean, this is how I came and discovered it and opened up a whole new world where I could then also now, wherever I'm traveling to, I want to dig and find out, you know, is this an Afrosynth record? You know, try and discogs it, try and go on your site and try and discover this music from South Africa. So that is a, you know, that's definitely a way you know you're getting this kind of message across about the sounds of South Africa in the 80s. And is there anything else that you kind of do in terms of getting this out? Is there any, because you were saying you're a journalist, so is there any writing?
I'm doing quite a lot these days, actually. That's part of the reason maybe why I don't have time to rip all these albums and treat Afrosynth like a label, like a commercial thing, you know. I'm currently the editor of a new music website called musicinafrica.net.
Okay.
It's basically a pan-African music website funded by the Goethe Institute.
Okay.
So it's got funding from German cultural agencies and Siemens Stiftung as well. Basically, we're trying to provide a platform for African artists to expose their product and also to link with other people in the continent. You know, we realize there's a gap between countries in Africa. It tends to be that only the biggest artists will break out in Europe or something, then they'll come back to another country in Africa sometimes to kind of tap into the pan-African market, you know.
So
we basically have a directory of people working in the music industry in Africa. Anyone involved in music, musicians, but also labels, studios, engineers, music schools. Anyone working in the music industry can create a profile in our directory and use it to kind of promote themselves and to connect with other people on the continent.
That's super.
For example, like
if
you're an artist in Zimbabwe and you really want to take a tour to Nigeria, you don't have to wait for a phone call. You can go to Music in Africa, find details of promoters in Lagos, call the dudes and hook yourself up, you know.
It's amazing. And so it's funny, it's you saying that because that's exactly what I'm involved in. Okay. I'm working with a few organizations, including the British Council, and we're also doing the same thing. At the moment, I'm involved in a project in East Africa, and I'm sort of assisting and helping with building an East African music identity.
Mm.
And I think our paths in terms of the business, Music is Africa, our paths has crossed recently in Zanzibar when I was there.
Right.
So I'm involved in exactly the same sort of thing, you know, being able to sort of expose and educate and also showcase a new young breed of musicians from Africa, not only South Africa or East Africa, but across the whole of Africa. And at the moment, we kind of focusing on East Africa, which I've just, I wouldn't say completed, but I've just been, traveled through Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania, which is kind of the East African region, and then also looking to do projects in South Africa with the British Council again. So it's it's funny.
I think the interest is growing, and the resources to create these kind of platforms are growing as well. Yeah. You know, so I think it's great. You know, and I'm really proud to be involved in a project like Music in Africa, to be able to look forward and to try and help musicians. You know, education is a large part of the site, so we're trying to help musicians, for example, learn about legal stuff, contracts, royalties, things like that, stuff that can actually turn them from an aspiring musician to a professional musician.
Exactly,
you know,
exactly.
With a pan-African or even a global audience, and not just a small local audience. So I'm really happy to be doing that, and it kind of plugs in nicely, I think, with Afrosynth, which is always looking back, you know, and giving credit to where these guys come from, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm really, like I say, I'm just happy to be involved in African music in any kind of way. You know, I'm going to start selling these records as well. Fairly soon, I'm opening a store in Maboneng here in Johannesburg.
Amazing.
Selling some Afrosynth records, a lot of them mint condition, still sealed, everything. So I'm looking forward to actually helping, not just through the blog, but also through physical vinyl, actually selling stuff to people. So if anybody is interested in purchasing some Afrosynth records, just drop me a line. It's DJ Okapi on Facebook. Yeah.
And just before we finish the session, DJ Okapi, where did the inspiration for the name come from?
I actually read a book. I don't know if people are aware, but in South Africa, an okapi is not just like an animal. It looks kind of like a zebra. It's also a switchblade. You know, it's like a township knife that people use here.
Yeah.
So I don't know. For me personally, I was just reading a biography back in the day of a guy called Godfrey Malloy, who was like the the father of Soweto, he's quite a larger than life guy, and he was always talking about getting in Okapi fights and whatever with guys. So it's kind of a symbol to me of South African culture, you can say, you know, street culture. And kind of think a bit harder about it, kind of related to me, I think, because the music that I'm playing, it kind of, it has an effect on people that I've seen when I play it live to people, and especially guys who relate to it, it gets in them, you know, it gets stuck in them. And once it's in there, you know, they can't shake it off sometimes, you know. So to me, this music is something that really pierces people, and once it's inside, you know, people feel it on like an emotional level. It's not just listening to dance and then go home or listening to party or whatever. It's more than that, you know.
There's substance in it. There's definitely substance in it. But listen, I could probably sit here all day, all night, you know, we could listen. I mean, I can imagine
this, just
get through this. But I just want to thank you for your time and giving me the opportunity to chat to you, you know. It's for me, the way this project came together was just last minute, and for me, I was just like, yes. And I managed to come, I mean, through some difficulties, almost missed a few flights.
That's what happens.
But I'm here, and again, thank you so much for your time, Dave. And
Man, thanks for being here, and big up to the Boiler Room guys. I really appreciate you guys taking interest in African music in general, not just me. So thanks to all you guys.
Nice one.
Nice one, bro. Nice one.